21 minutes to 9 and time to do Dorset Lives. And our Dorset Lives guest today could be an inspiration to anyone who's hoping their dream of writing a book may one day bear fruit. Jill Davey Bowker is from Manor Park in Dorchester. She's set to do a book signing for her first novel in the town on Saturday. But it all springs from her taking up writing as a result of having to leave her job as a nurse prematurely. Now, Jill joins me in the studio now. Good morning to you.
Hello.
And this is the book, The Meltdown of a Banker's Wife, which we'll talk about the content of in a moment. But I'm very impressed by how you wrote it. You're telling me off air there, you've conned your brain into not letting it know you were writing a book.
That's it, yeah. I sort of like divided it into two and I started writing it in pencil, 4 pages at a time for 3 months. Mm-hmm. And all the time I was saying to myself, no, I'm not really writing a book. But I thought it could be a good book. And there was like this dichotomy.
And all the time this pile of pages is stacking up. Yeah. And you're saying you're unstapling it and keeping it safe to one side.
Yeah.
So when you started writing, did you start at the beginning of the story? Or is it one of these things where you condensed it into 4 pages, then gradually as time went on, you expanded it out into book length?
I started at the beginning and I just carried on writing and it morphed itself into what it is now, which is a sort of satire, really, of about the banking crisis.
Mm-hmm. Very current thing. I'll be honest, I haven't seen a copy of the book, haven't read it, but what a title, The Meltdown of a Banker's Wife.
Yeah.
what happens? What can you tell us about it?
It's set around a family. It starts off her with two really impossible children, one of whom is really interested in insects and always wants to go to a place called Aphid World. And the Aphid World name came from Ollie in the morning saying to me about there was a plant in our kitchen that has all these aphids on it. Mm-hmm. And I said, where have these come from? We haven't got any around here. And Ollie said, "There's if you go down the bottom of the garden, it's like Aphid World down there." Mm-hmm. So the theme park name came from that. And it started off being called Aphid World. And then because it was the banking crisis at the time,
yeah.
And I was very interested and also scared about the prospects of a massive major depression like the 30s, I sort of made it into a sort of funny sort of take on that, because the husband is a banker and they live in London. And he's a sort of city banker, so he's very rich, and she can just splash money wherever she wants.
On trips to Aphid World, whenever she likes.
Aphid World. She'd rather not go there, as her brother's also not very interested in going there.
It's sort of many remarkable elements to this, not least the fact that having sat there and written it 4 pages at a time in pencil, longhand in pencil,
yeah.
you then got this element where it's like, well, I don't want to lose this, having put all the work in. And so you found a solicitor's whose safe box you could lock it in.
Yeah, in their strong room.
Wow. Yeah. It's like something from Ocean's 11.
I know. It's just to preserve the copyright.
Right, so they have a master's copy somewhere, a master copy rather, and then you are sending copies out to agents trying your best to get it published.
Yes, but, I mean, first of all, I had to acquire a computer, and I hate computers as well. I'm absolutely terrified of
things. You had to acquire a computer? You make it sound like it fell off the back of a lorry.
Yeah, well, it wasn't quite that. It was more of a Christmas present, really.
Right, okay.
It was a little pink computer, so it wasn't scary.
Yeah.
It's one of these little netbooks, and I didn't have Windows or any special programs on it, so I had to just like type it in as it was and then it had to be formatted into that when we finally managed to get Word onto the.
So that was you transcribing the longhand stuff that you'd written into something which you could then send away, and you then had this very long battle, amazing ability to take rejection with agents and publishers. Is it 35 no's that you had?
35 no's.
Wow.
Yeah. But I kept thinking to myself, J.K. Rowling apparently had 27, not saying that's anything like J.K. Rowling.
You say that,
Jill. She had 27 rejections. The person that wrote The Help had 60 rejections.
Wow.
So it just kept me going. And I thought, and most of them, they just hadn't even looked at it. They just turn around and send it back the next day.
Yeah.
And say, oh, we haven't got anything on our list requiring a book like this. But they hadn't even read it. You knew that.
And what happened when you finally found somebody who said yes to you?
I was all over the place. First of all, I didn't really believe it, and then it was just a surreal experience, to be honest.
How did they tell you? By email, by post, by phone call?
Phone call and then letter.
I can't imagine what that must have been like.
Yeah.
turning cartwheels around the room, I should imagine.
And then bit by bit, it's been like, I don't believe this. And then a bit of work, like scary work, like having to copy editing and all that. And I couldn't believe how many mistakes were in there. You had to keep changing.
Oh, I'm dreadful for that. Like, I will absolutely believe that I am fastidious with my grammar and my spelling. Mm-hmm. And then quite often I'll read back something that I've written a few months later and just think, what was I thinking? There's so many errors in here. But it doesn't matter, because that's why there's a publishing industry. They will help you take care of all that stuff.
Yeah.
And then is it May of this year that you finally get a physical copy that you can hold in your hands?
Yeah, it's the end of May.
Wow, what did that feel like?
Really strange. I didn't think it was going to be such a big book, to be honest. I didn't think it, I thought it was quite tiny, but it's actually a fair size.
Well, more power to you. If you're writing 4 pages a day for 3 months, it really should be. So, signing in town on Saturday, are those... Do you tend to get people who've read it coming in to meet you, or is it a case of sitting in a bookshop and trying to convince people why they should buy it? What happens?
Well, the author board's out there already. Mm-hmm. I have told friends and family and everything, and I'm just hoping people will turn up.
Yeah.
I have got cupcakes there that my next door neighbour made.
Yeah.
In the sort of, and it looks actually like the front of the book. The book cover's covered in daisies of different colours in a swirl. And so cupcakes are there, and that might be an added attraction.
Yeah, of course. And equally, I mean, I think, I'm sure I should know, but which bookstore is it happening in?
Waterstones in Dorchester.
Right. So people will be in there, I'm sure, on a Saturday, certainly during half term. Mm. And if you get a chance to talk to them, explain who you are and that you're local.
Yeah.
I imagine that copies will fly off the shelves.
I hope so. It is completely mad and funny book. Mm. And everyone who's read it, I've had 5-star customer reviews.
Oh, great.
And people who've read it said it's like laugh out loud, and, you know, they've been giggling on holiday, and other people have asked them, what are you reading? And they've bought it online while they're on holiday and things.
And the issue that you've got now is, having gone through all that and that sort of turmoil of writing in pencil, buying a computer, to transcribing it, approaching 35 different publishing houses, people like me will ask you, what's next?
I mean, as it came to an end, it could have carried on, and so there could be a sequel.
Right. Do you like that idea, or would you rather try and do something completely different?
I have got a very scary story in mind, but I quite like writing a funny story because it lifts your mood. And whereas if you go into something dark, I don't know how I'd feel going into this dark story that I'm thinking about.
I was listening to Anthony Horowitz being interviewed the other day, because he's just released his new book, and he was saying he's lost count of the number of books that he's written, and he has pretty much written one a year for like the last 30 years. And I just think you've got to become, to a certain extent, completely natural, almost more of a typist than a writer at that stage. If you're just turning that stuff out year after year, you've really got to suit up for it.
Yeah, I suppose, you know, after a while it becomes a formula. You know, I'll do this stage and that stage, but at the moment I'm sort of at the beginning of all that sort of...
Yeah, do you think you'll write the next one on the computer, or will you stick with the old pencil?
Pencil.
All right, well, look, good luck with it. So Saturday in Waterstones, from what time?
10 till 12.
Okay, in Dorchester. And the book, if you want to try and find it online, if you're listening in a part of Dorset that is further afield than Dorchester, it's called The Meltdown of a Banker's Wife by Jill Davy Boker. Have I got that pronunciation right, by the way?
Davy Bowker.
Bowker. Yeah. I thought it might be the case. All right. Thank you very much for coming in. Really lovely to see you.
Thanks very much. Nice to meet you.